Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Matt Naylor, and I'm really thrilled to welcome you here to the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and especially to have the opportunity, Sonia, to be with you.
Thank you
for being here.
Thank you for having me.
It's sort of special being next to someone who's so famous.
Oh, I'm just a humble little human being like all of you, except I came out from a horrible, horrible hell. It's indescribable. I would like to just say something and compliment the gentleman who wrote those, the poetry. It's so accurately, exactly the way it was, you put it. And I really, really want to, again, thank you for everyone that you put it so exactly the way it was.
Wonderful, thank you. So it all began for you in Europe. So tell us about where are you from and when were you born?
Okay. I was born in November 10, 1925. Our hometown, it's on the eastern part of Poland. And I would like to mention to you that people probably don't realize, even you read about the history, that the Eastern, first of all, Hitler did not have any concentration camps on his soil. All of those concentration camps were on the Polish soil, especially in the eastern part where I come, closer to Ukraine and Belarus. Because I would like to explain to you the distinction. Concentration camps are those where they had gas chambers. And the labor camps, the others, they had, when it was on the German soil, they had only, to burn the people, gas chambers and crematoria, only crematoria. Because matter of fact, I was liberated in Bergen-Belsen, and this was on the German soil, yes. They did only have one crematoria, and people were dying by the thousands and thousands. You can imagine the piles of the dead bodies around. We were liberated by the English, and it was really unbelievable. So I'm giving you a little example.
Yes.
What did take place. The most deadliest camps he put on the eastern part. And also to let you know that sometimes in the history we'll not read about it, the Ukrainians and the Latvians joined the SS, and they were most horrible, horrible things what they did. Just sometimes worse than the SS themselves.
Yes.
Because
so
if you
Sonia,
read it, yes.
So the you had a brother and a sister. If we
yes,
see in this
yes,
picture
yes.
here, we so were, describe who circled here.
Okay, we were three children at home.
So Gideon.
Gideon is my brother.
Yes.
Over there, you can see.
So
the
he's
youngest.
Circled there in the.
This little circle, it's me.
Yes, in the left
he's
photo.
He's not here. It's me and my little sister, when you see with the little, the shortest one.
Yes.
Yeah, this was my little sister. She survived.
Manya.
Manya, yeah, Manya is her name. And her surviving is unbelievable.
And so we'll get to that.
Yeah.
And your brother as well, who is in the photo on the right at a better meeting.
I beg your pardon?
It's at a meeting. Your brother is
My brother is not here.
Oh.
No, he's not on this. This is not the entire family.
Yes.
It's just part of the family. My mother is there. My grandma is there. None of them survived on this picture except myself, when you see, and my little sister there, on the end.
So, here, Sonia, in the photograph on the left
yes.
of the family wedding, only two of you from that photograph survived.
Correct.
Everybody else was murdered.
Gone, yeah. Most of Treblinka.
So that's early in the war, halfway through.
That's right.
All were murdered except for you and your sister.
Correct.
And your brother is in the right-hand photograph.
over there.
Yes.
Yes, you see, when he was the youngest. This was an organization in Poland, a Jewish organization, what they were dreaming to go to Israel, when it was not Israel yet there, you know, and they were trained to be soldiers. I don't know if you know about the history, but the Irgun, this was an underground organization that they were going through trainings, and it was secretly. This was one of our little forests. In the summer, they came and trained those, all of those young men mostly are really very high caliber, you know.
Yes.
Smart, yes. And they were trained to go later to fight in Israel.
Including your brother.
My brother was the youngest, and they did not, you know, take him in, and he was really very disappointed, yes.
And then this series of photographs, we have a picture of your grandmother.
Yeah, this is my grandmother, and that's my daddy, and this is my oldest daughter from my grandmother, my aunt, yes.
And who of those survived?
From this picture here, none of them survived. None of them.
So all
went to Treblinka.
All went to Treblinka and were murdered.
And here also, my grandma, you see, and this is her oldest daughter and her husband, all gone. This is my cousin there. And he survived. He survived also in the camps like me, but he's already gone, you know. And he came to Israel when 1947, whenever, 1948, correct?
So, ladies and gentlemen, Sonia's painting the scope of tragedy here, that very few, your sister, your aunt, your cousin?
My cousin. And my, that's all.
Were the survivors, everybody else in the extended
gone.
Family was murdered.
Except, excuse me, we have my daddy's two sisters and a brother. They left Poland like maybe 4 or 5 years before the war. So that helped me to get,
they were in
you know, little
harbor.
Pictures. When you see the picture there of my aunt, this is already from Argentina, send it to me, whatever. Otherwise, I wouldn't have a single picture.
Well, Sonia, it helps us understand the scale of the tragedy. It's almost unfathomable.
That's
the
right.
The scale of tragedy in your personal life, let alone, of course, for the larger Jewish community, of course, it's unfathomable. But for you, this is unfathomable. And it began here in your town when the ghetto then was established, which means that the Germans came to your town. When did they come? And do you remember that happening?
Yes, I remember. They came in 1939 in, it was, you know, September, I believe, yes. And first our city went through a very hard time. If you remember from history that Hitler and Stalin decided about, you know, where is going to be the borders. So we filed in to the Russians. And I don't know how many weeks, I cannot recall. And then later Hitler changed his mind and he made up with Stalin that it will be farther more to the eastern part. So we went through a very hard time.
So then you fell into the, within
back
the
to
area
the Germans.
Of the Germans.
We went to the Germans.
So then the Germans came to your town in 39.
Yes.
And the SS troops entered. What did they do?
This is what I want to mention to you, that the regular army was not vicious, and a lot of them, I am sure, don't think that Hitler managed to brainwash all of the Germans.
Yes.
And I would say among the fighters in the army were against him too. It would be too long to mention to you why I'm saying this from my own experience. But anyway, I can only tell you one thing. There was a very high-ranked man, and he was close with my father. And before they already have to leave, they knew they're going to, you know, fight with Russia. He told us he felt so bad for us. He knew what Hitler already is doing with us, so I'll never forget. And he sent us with his, they call it in German, you know, Denstück, that means he was waiting on him. And he sent us some bread and marmalade, I remember. And he was saying in German, Gottes Willen, because he fought in the World War First, and he was against Hitler. And he was telling us, I'm so sorry, what's waiting for us? We couldn't believe it. We couldn't realize what really is waiting for us. Because a lot of us also, when the Russians had to leave, you know, a lot of people were communistic. They knew if the German comes, they will be the first one also to be killed. So they left. And they were telling us, and we didn't believe it, it's waiting for us horrible things, you know, but, you know, propaganda from the Russian side too those days, sure. We didn't believe it.
So then they forced you to wear yellow stars?
Yeah, when the SS came in, they started all of this horrible
things. Yellow stars, not being able to go to school?
No Jewish children could go to school anymore. And
No Jewish children to walk on the sidewalk?
Correct. And we had a limited time. And they did it gradually, right away that was impossible for them. Our city, we had, I think, six, you know, deportations.
Yes.
The deportations, I want you to know from the beginning, no one really believed. The way they handled it, the Germans, it's unbelievable. And even later on, when people start jumping the trains when they're going to to their dead, we didn't realize, we didn't believe. Even somebody jumped and came, told the story.
Your grandfather lost his business?
My grandfather died before the war. My grandma was running a little, you know, restaurant.
Yes.
And her daughters helped her, you
so
know,
the,
running
but
it.
When the SS came,
all gone.
Jewish were no longer permitted to own businesses?
No, they were taken away. And a lot of, also I tell you the episode, the first thing what I, yes. you know, experienced, and it was horrible. When they came in, just in a few days, they took out our old rabbis. In matter of fact, in our hometown, we had even a very higher, you know, than a rabbi. He was famous all over the world.
Yes.
I still remember as a child when he died, they came from all over to his, you know. Anyway, they took out all those rabbis and we had to watch it. It's right in the street and they were picking, you know, the beards, not cutting.
They were
but
tearing
just
the beard
tearing
out.
The beards, and they were all with blood. And we had to watch him the way they killed him.
So
and from then on, we knew.
He was killed in the public.
In
and
the
you
public,
were forced
on
to
the
watch.
Street, and we had to watch, yeah.
Yeah. Tragic.
It really, in the 20th century, I want you to know, it is impossible even to grasp what sadism one human being
yes,
can do,
can
to,
do
another
to another.
One.
Right.
Not only that, what is so, so important to remember, that Germany and Austria were the highest cultures, not only in Europe, in the whole world.
Mm.
You know what I'm talking about.
So even those who are very educated, those who have great culture, still
absolutely.
Do horrendous things.
Matter of fact, I'm going to tell you something that really you will not see it in the books. When right in the beginning, you see, in Poland, the smaller towns did not have any stations. Our city happened to be very, you know, we had a lot of bristle brushes, factories, so, you know, we had to have a train. So in the beginning, right in the beginning, we could see trains coming from France. And those, you know, they had medals, what they fought in the World War First, high caliber, you know, what they gave their lives for Germany. And they put them in luxurious trains. Only tell them, you can take in so much, we are settling you. and everything will be fine. And this is the way they were doing, yes. Even in Treblinka, when you arrived, there was a made it outside like it's a station, and even flowers and so on. People didn't know to the last time.
Yes.
Unless later on, you know, we are starting to
So in 1943 then is when the deportations began from your town, and you were deported. Tell us, from your family, your sister, your brother, your mother, yourself, tell us about when they came to round the people up for the deportation.
Okay, I'm going.
And what happened with your father and your brother.
Okay. When I tell you, it's very important to mention about it. My father, you know, was doing business with a very wonderful guy, a Christian fellow. When the war broke out, he decided to move away back to his little village. And guess what? One day the ghetto was still open. He made a special trip. He came to us very quietly to tell us, I'm coming to tell you what is happening if they round you up. You are going to your death. He described it everything because his village was right there close to Treblinka.
So he knew what was happening.
Yes.
And he came as a friend to say, be careful when it happens, it's a death sentence.
Try as long as you can
to hide.
Yes. And that's what we did. Our family left it, you know. And then
did you hide?
My daddy with some, you know, other friends, they built a hiding place under. We in the ghetto, we were so lucky just with one room, and that's all.
So one room
under the bed.
And under the bed,
correct.
A special place to hide
to
in
hide.
The floor.
Yes.
So you could lift the boards up, and the family could get down hide.
That's right.
For when they came around.
Yeah, because even the ghetto was horrible times. Sometimes they would come just for fun, you know, just kill people. When we heard the shots, we always right away would hide it. But when they came already, it was the fifth deportation, I believe, before the last one. And they came this time with German shepherds. And they sniffed us out.
So the dogs came into your house,
they
smelt that you were under, and you were then found.
In our, a room, only one room, because there were other apartments.
Sure.
Yes. And after they sniffed us out, naturally, they took us out, and we had to kneel, you know, against the wall from that building. And while we were, you know, kneeling, my youngest sister really went into a trauma. She said, I'm going to die. We thought that they will kill us right there on the spot. So anyway, it will be too long to explain to you how it happened.
Yes.
She was sitting next to my daddy by the wall, and then I was here with my mother. And he pushed her back to the place where you could go back in. They knew that they will not go back to look for us again. So, and then, in a moment, finally they were taking out people from other hiding places. So we had to stand up and walking to the city square, usually. And there we were kneeling, and from there they took us to the cattle trains. In that moment, when we were standing up, my father managed to escape. So when we left, my father was still, you know, alive, and my little sister, and my brother. My brother was not in the ghetto, because also from my father's acquaintance, he had a son who was an engineer, and he was very nice taking in my brother, and so he was out, sleeping even out of the ghetto. And it was a tremendous help for us, because he had, he could come to the ghetto and bring us a little extra, you know, food, had a permission, you know. So this was a great help. You know.
So when your father escaped from the town square, did he take your daughter Manya with him? So your father and your sister
Correct.
Made an escape.
Yes.
But you and your mother were deported.
Yes, were deported. You want me to tell about
your mom? So let's just, your sister went and was cared for in the forest.
Not right away.
But she then made her way to safety, but your father was murdered.
My father and my brother.
And your brother.
But I have to let you know how my sister wound up, you know, that way. When my brother, like I mentioned, he had a way to be out of the ghetto and be in contact sometimes with some villages and so on. So one day, later on after the war, I got, told, she told me the story. He approached one farmer and he said, listen, we'll pay you, every week I'll come, he was a hero, he was not a skiff. I cannot go on and tell you stories about him. Anyway, he said, I'll come every week and pay you. And he decided, and he took her in. So she was on this farm, I don't know how long, but then after, when it was already Judenrein, that means no more Jews, and my brother and my father, we knew already ahead what is waiting, that they have to hide, and they are, I imagine, they were planning to hide and then pick up my little sister and join the partisans. You know, the partisans would have fought in the forest. So anyway, it didn't work out like this. When they hid it, someone, a young student, a Christian young man, which I remembered after my sister, after a deliberation, she was telling me, he betrayed him. The betraying was, he was getting, I don't know how much sugar and a bread, and he betrayed him. And they took him out and they killed him. And there were witnesses, from
so
other people there.
So betrayed and told that your father was there.
The SS came.
And then they took him and murdered your father.
Yes, my father and my brother.
And your brother.
Correct. Mm. And they buried him, it was not even any more space where to bury. It was, outskirts from the city. And my little sister, since she was already with this farmer, as soon he got the news that they are not getting any more money, they let her go.
So he then ceased caring for her because he was no longer being paid by your father because your father had been murdered. And so he then told her to leave. And then she went with the partisans in the forest.
Yeah, my father and my brother were
And you both
yeah.
were murdered.
Yes.
Yeah,
so
where is the humanity
correct.
In that?
You're correct, yes. And then it's a too long story to tell you what
so
happened.
So then you were sent to Treblinka, which is a death camp, but you didn't
Completely
stay there.
Death camp. One moment. When we knew we were going to Treblinka, we knew already at that time exactly, especially after our friend was telling us. And this is what helped me about something to mention later. When this friend of my daddy's told us about it, my mama right away gave us some money. I was wearing boots. In case something happened, you never know. So I had some money in my boots. The day when they put us on the train, me and my mother, I want you to know, it was May the 3rd, I still remember, 1943, because on May the 3rd, my brother was born, and it was his birthday. They put us in just like herring. You couldn't even move. So you can imagine, children, babies, elderly people, you couldn't even move. And people were dying right and left from thirst.
In the train.
And I have to describe it to you. In the summer, they were putting us in the closed kettle trains. In the winter, farther, I'll tell you, open trains.
Right.
Yes.
So part of the torture, put you on a very hot train in the summertime, jam-packed. In the wintertime, they were placing people in open carts. In the freezing.
Correct.
Anticipating, I'm sure, Sonia, that people would die.
Absolutely.
All part of the strategy.
And the time when we were already, the train was going fast, who do you think was sitting on that top of that long train? Ukrainians and the it's unbelievable. Because already, a lot of our men that we knew were going to our dead, and they had already special gadgets just in case to open and jump. And it is really very interesting that people normally I wouldn't know either. when you jump, when the train is going in the fast, you know, motion, you have a 99, 100% to survive, but you have to jump where the train in the energy. Then when they start already, the Ukraine is noticing that people are jumping, naturally, they won't try to stop the train. In the ones where they jump later, they didn't have a big chance. 50, 15, and even smaller.
Yes.
Some died, yes. And some survived, the ones where they jumped. So anyway, what I want to tell you, they will go and close it up. And this is some friends of ours, you know, men who they jumped. I would jump if I wouldn't be with my mom, but I couldn't do it.
So you told your mother you would like to jump. Your mother said no, because then you would be on your own.
Yeah,
she couldn't jump.
She wouldn't jump. No.
She wouldn't jump.
So I decided to
stay with her on the train.
Yeah.
Went to Treblinka, but the lines were too long.
I beg your pardon?
Was the lines, the processing?
I'll mention to you. The train had only one small little window. And wired. And suddenly we noticed our train stopped. We didn't know for what reason. And while, you know, meanwhile, so many already dead, I can tell you, I was standing on dead bodies to reach that little opening, and I managed, you know, take out some money from my, you know, boots, and I took a chance. Some of those, you know, Christian men, Polish, worked on the train, on the station, and I was lucky. He handed over to me a canteen with water.
So you paid money and you got the water.
He was good. Some of them would not take the money, not give it, but he was.
And
had
you
more
took
heart.
A drink.
I took a sip, and then till today. I'll be honest with you, I don't remember if my mother, because I want her to give a sip of the water. I will only can tell you that dying from thirst is even worse than dying from malnutrition and other things. It's a horrible death. And people were just becoming like, you know, animals. Everyone wants a sip of the water. And suddenly we didn't realize our train, we felt that is railing, we felt it. And later on, we managed to know what happened. Treblinka could not kill the people fast enough, and there were a lot of trains still standing. So our train was railed to Majdanek. Mm-hmm. This was also a concentration camp, and it is really very close from my hometown to Lublin, is a very famous, you know. And this exactly, you could see even people's houses across.
Right.
So close.
So close to where the people lived.
Exactly.
And so then you arrived at Majdanek.
When we arrived in Majdanek, believe it or not, I don't know how many were already dead. They still, the SS waited for us. They opened, you know, the train, the doors. And the ones who still were alive, they performed, you know, a selection. And then we learned from the first selection what it means left and right. Left, you were going to the guest chamber. Majdanek had only one guest chamber and one crematorium. And luckily at that moment, I fell in with my mom to the right, and the others, you know, went to the left. I would like to tell you, you want to know a little about Majdanek camp?
Yes.
Or you have another question?
Yes.
I don't want to go against
tell
you.
Tell us about the Majdanek camp.
Yeah, okay. Majdanek, when we arrived, first, you know, we went through also the showers, took away our clothes, I don't have to tell you about it. And then we are assigned in barracks, they were just wooden barracks. And I can tell you, when we arrived to this camp, they did not have any latrines. They had only digged up holes. And all the feces from the holes we were carrying to fertilizing for the, you know, in the fields. And also, I would like to mention to you that was from all of those SS there, one which any woman in this world cannot describe, I mean, to believe that we can be also such bestial.
Mm-hmm.
And she, I was, testifying against her after the war. It's a long story, but I would like to describe her to you. I should have brought a picture if I would have known. Anyway, because the English took pictures later. Anyway, if she caught you that you didn't walk out to work, if you didn't hide it, and if she caught you, she will dump you to those fetids to death.
So they would push you into the latrine holes?
Correct. That's what she did. And also, describing her, she was tall. I would never forget, I still remembered her name. And she was, you know, what shall I say? I cannot even describe it. And for example, we were counted twice in mm-hmm. every camp. And she would go around, and if, you know, we always stood in five in the counting. And I always tried to be in the middle or in the end. I used, you know, the sixth sense in the camps, otherwise I wouldn't be here, I want you to know. Anyway, if she saw you, you didn't stand up straight, or you didn't look right, she would put the German shepherds on you. One day we came from the fields, and we noticed that something is taking place. And sure enough, I shall never forget as long as I shall live, were two girls probably my age. They tried to escape and they got caught. And then here, there are two SS women, and the girls were carrying little stools to be able to reach for hanging, you know, to the ropes. And we had to stay like in a, you know, almost not round, but a square, in a square. And we had to watch it. I'll never forget, my mom was still, you know, in their life. The SS, and she turned her head, and she slapped her, said, you have to watch
forced,
it.
Forced you forced all you. To watch the murder, the two
correct.
Young girls.
Correct. And I'll never, shall never forget in my life, and this is my duty to tell you. Before already the last shriek, when they took away the little stones,
yes.
and before they died, their last shriek was in our language. She spit on the SS woman,
yes.
and then they said in our language, never forget and take revenge.
Yes.
This was their last words.
Yes.
Their bodies were lying for days, it
yes.
was summer, for us to see if yeah. you will go and try
right.
to, what's waiting for you. And
right.
then they took him to the crematoria.
Right. A tragic. Story.
The next one, I want to tell you a horrible
yes.
that happened. Besides, it's been too long to tell you everything. It's really important in my life to mention about it. First of all, I want to say if I wouldn't be with my mom in Majdanek, I wouldn't have made it because dysentery was, you know, horrible. Girls were dying for it. If not my mom, I wouldn't have made it. And remember, please, the motherly love is the highest in this world. I always mention wherever I speak. The father loves you too, but it's a different love. Because how many times we had only one, you know, for water to fetch a well, and you had to get up because 5 o'clock they already counted us, that happened very early. And my mama's little hand would say, come on, stay on, I'll go and fetch the little water just, you know, to refresh yourself. So you cannot forget this love from your mom. So one day, I don't know how many of you know about Joseph Mengele.
Yes.
He was the one doing all
yes.
kind of experiments on us. And his specialty was, you know, twins and little short people,
yes.
how do you call them, yes. And then our young people, men and women. His hub really was Auschwitz-Birkenau. For what reason the day that he came to Majdanek, I cannot explain this. But anyway, it was right outside, I would say around, you know, where everything gets ready already on the fields, I remember the time. And he arrived in Majdanek to have a selection. When we had to, you know, take off our clothes, and that was outside. And he was standing in some of the SS women and SS men, and he was performing this selection. And we already knew what it means, right and left. When we came in front of him, he put my mom to the left and me to the right. And I would like to tell you, in that moment, I wanted to go with my mom. Mm-hmm. But the SS woman was pushing me to the right. So anyway, to make the story short, the ones where they were assigned to go to the gas chamber, they left them. You see, every camp had fields, field one, field two, and so on. So the ones like myself to the right, they took us to another field. And the ones who would go to the gas chamber, they stayed on, you know, that night over there. Right in the morning, you know, they call it in German, Blocksperre. That means if you hear, you know, a siren, you knew there's something is taking place that you don't want you to see. So that moment when I hear the siren, it's something like a power was pushing me to the main big doors from the barrack. And luckily, this was just a little tiny peephole. And I'll never forget this as long as I shall live. I saw my mom walking with another lady from my hometown. I recognized, and they hold at each other also in fives, you know. This was the last time I saw my mom
and Sonia,
walking to the gas chamber.
She was walking to the gas chamber.
Yeah, a whole, you know, other women, you know, yeah. Whole line, you know.
Yeah, it's incomprehensible for us to understand the terror of that and the extraordinary
sadness. I really broke down
at
the time. I broke down.
Yeah.
And then right in the morning, next day, also in cattle trains, they took us to Auschwitz-Birkenau.
Right. So then you went to Auschwitz, and where you stayed for about 1.5 years more. And whilst you're at Auschwitz, then you were marked. Tell us about the mark that you were.
Oh, you mean the?
Yes.
Yeah, when they tattooed us.
Yes.
Actually, I want to point it out to you for history. Only Birkenau, Auschwitz put the numbers on us. In other camps, they had it outside, you know. So I don't know if I'll be able to push
Tell
this
us
up.
The number.
My number, it's unbelievable. The first 486 is very eerie, starts my social security number.
It's the same as the beginning of your social security number.
486, you see? 486,
yes.
And there is a 89.
Yes.
It was. Yeah.
Now, what did you tell your children later about that mark?
You can imagine that when they're already little, you know, they're still little, and they notice this number. I don't know how would you, you know, explain when the child asks you, Mama, what is this?
Yes.
And you have to give the child the answer.
Yes.
And you know, for what I said to, you know, if Mama will get lost, they will be able to find me. This is the only thing that came to me in the moment.
What else could
you say? Yes.
To a 6-year-old,
exactly,
a 7-year-old
exactly,
who's asking.
Exactly.
And when did you begin to tell the children then about the horror that you faced for so many years? When did you begin to tell them?
I would like to mention first, this is what we all only had. We gave him the highest education.
Yes.
We did everything, what you know. It was hard to build a life, you know, when you come to a new country. But they felt the love, I'm sure. But also, when I watched, you know, finally the film myself, I always cry because I have not realized as much. And later I read a book about it, that all the children from survivors were also affected.
Yes.
Especially when they start attending the high school.
Yes.
And they felt different.
Yes.
In something they felt, even no matter how love we tried to give them. And it shows in the film, and I always have to cry, that they were affected too. They felt different. They didn't have, you know, like grandmother and grandfathers and all the other children were happy.
Yes.
So it affected them. And when they made the movie, they put the truth, what really is happening. And all of the, mostly, so some of our survivors never could tell, you know, really the story. And this maybe was not good either, but I would not criticize. It's not always, it's not easy.
Yes. When we will talk about you moving to the United States soon, but I'm wondering for the audience who are interested in writing and about storytelling, when did you begin to want to tell the stories?
Yes.
When did that happen? Has that been just later in your life? Or is this something?
Not right away, no. It took, the only thing I cannot tell you the year. I only can tell you, maybe you can figure out. I don't know how many of you remember the skinheads.
Yes.
And first of all, I want to tell you, when I came out from this hell, it's like our veterans, you call it, you know, they get now help for it, but we never did. You call it the guilt of surviving, survivor's guilt. Mm. Believe me, I wouldn't wish even on my greatest enemy to feel this. And even I felt guilty when people were having, you know, something funny, they were laughing. I would catch myself, how can I even smile?
Yes.
But one day, on the radio, I heard the skinheads. It's the skinheads.
Yes.
And I want you to know, they were not allowed in Germany to do it. So this is something what really bothered me too. Why those killers and haters come here and taking advantage on our wonderful First Amendment.
Yes.
That bothers me.
Yes.
When I hear this on the radio, the denial, it's like a thunder came to my brain saying to me, hey, Sonia, this is the first denial I heard. I couldn't believe it. This is the reason you survived. You have to start speaking about it.
Yeah.
And how many times were some of them were dying, you know, still they knew they're dying. They would tell us, if you will make it, tell the story to the world.
Yeah, if you make it, tell the story to the world. This is what some of the people who were being murdered were saying.
Yes.
And you remembered that.
Yes, yes.
That if you...
And that made me strong.
Yes.
It gave me the strength because when I start speaking, I speak for those who didn't make it.
So the words of the murdered, you're telling their story as much as your story. And they give you strength to tell your story.
Correct. What I witnessed and what I have seen. Remember, you know, when I came to Auschwitz-Birkenau, I walked.
Yes.
And then later they built a train.
Yes.
To kill the people faster. And I happened to be, I don't know if you can see it here, there is one where I was located and I even recognized the barrack. Anyway, it's another story.
That is a long story. We're going to move to Bergen-Belsen.
Oh, okay. I would like to tell you about when I came, they had four gas chambers and four crematories. While I was there, in another thing I mentioned to you, my barrack was very close from the crematory, two. One on this side and one this side. And then, like I mentioned to you, then they put a train to kill the people faster. So I hear so many, so many things that I cannot, you know, be too long to tell you. So then they built the biggest one, the fifth one, while I was there. And we were building the roads. We were doing, you know, work what even men, you know, would be doing. And I received two tremendous, horrible beatings. I went through all those selections, which will take too long, but I only mentioned to you in Trumengele. It's really, and I close my eyes, I don't believe it.
Yes.
It was a miracle. But I'll be completely honest with you. When I talk about miracle, that my surviving was a miracle, and then I catch myself, there's two ways to look at it. How many times when I have seen babies going to the gas chambers, and mothers, you know, putting their lives when they took away the children from them, you know. It's very easy to commit suicide there. And a lot of, you know, it's too long, I cannot tell you everything. So anyway, and sometimes in my mind I was asking, a miracle should show, like we read in the Bibles, you know, all kind of, if maybe one big miracle, this is my opinion, then when I say, It was a miracle the way I myself survived. So it's a question mark of
a survivor. So you became the miracle. You became the miracle.
Yes, I was the miracle, yes.
So from Auschwitz to Bergen-Belsen, the conditions were horrendous. Dead bodies, people suffering, people dying of typhus,
horrible.
People dragging bodies into the crematorium. Here also the Nazis were not actively murdering Jews anymore, but many died simply as a result
from beatings and
the conditions of the camp.
Yeah, because we had malaria, we had tuberculosis, and we had also, typhus.
And it was getting closer toward the end of the war at this
point.
Yes,
the Russians liberated Auschwitz-Birkenau.
Yes.
Yes.
So now let's skip ahead because we are close this part out. That then on April the 15th then, what happened on April the 15th in 1945?
Okay, we're not talking about the death march and so on. Okay, you know what took place. So we are jumping very fast.
We're jumping a lot. Okay. That will be for the movie.
Yes.
People will need to watch the movie.
Okay.
We'll tell you where you can get it in a few moments.
I get it.
But
okay.
Let's talk about then, on the 15th of April in 1945, what happened for you?
It was April 15. April 15. And I want to explain what really happened in that day. I was very lucky to fall in a group that we were working next to the kitchen,
Yes.
I was not strong to be in the kitchen. It was a peeling barn.
So you were peeling vegetables.
I was in the peeling barn, with friends from France. We had women from all over Europe. And like I mentioned, even from Greece, they didn't make it. Anyway, so this day, when we came to work, in the front of this barn was piles and piles of Rudabakers with the dirt, And then was, one of the German guards watching across from us was a men's camp, and there was cannibalism
there.
Correct.
Yeah. People were desperate.
They had, livers.
Yes.
And especially we had quite a few Russian soldiers who fell into the German. They were also in that camp with our men.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. When I arrived there, I'll never forget this. I was seeing half, that man dragging all those, skeleton of the bodies. Like I mentioned to you, it was only one crematoria. And thousands of people were dying every day.
Yes.
So you have your imagination what was around. When the English arrived, I want to tell you, you want to know how it happened. So one day when we arrived, we felt something is different because we didn't see that many SS people always guarding the
guards,
kitchen.
Some of the guards had gone, but there
probably
was just a small group of guards left.
Exactly, you are very good.
And then you felt the ground.
Yes, how I felt it, while I was sitting inside and we felt something. So the latrine was outside.
Yes.
I decided to go out there because you could have a bigger view.
Yes.
It was a very big, camp. And sure enough, when something had to happen, I wish, I would have stayed along because I already saw the tanks coming.
So the rumbling that you were feeling, the ground shaking, were the British tanks coming in to liberate the camp.
So I was so excited, I want to go back in and tell the girls what I see. In the meanwhile, the men's camp, they already start feeling that too. And where does the hungry run? To the kitchen, mostly grasp those Rudabakers, even with the dirt, you know what hunger can do. And this guard had still the guts, start shooting while they were running. And I was, running back to my place. I was standing like this, and he was shooting. The miracle was, if he would shot me farther, I would not make it. because of that short distance, the bullet came through and also wounded slightly two other girls. And I can tell you, at the moment when I got, you know, the bullet, I didn't feel, I knew something is happening to me until I had blood coming from my mouth. When I started, you know, seeing the blood, I knew I'm dying. And I was talking to the Almighty. I was swallowing the blood, don't ask me for what reason. And I say, after what I went through.
Yes, on this Liberation Day, this liberation, being shot, and thinking that you're dying, and then a Russian
and I have to
picks you, and then you are nursed back.
One Russian man came in, and he picked me up. And already through the window I could see, because he took me out for the first aid when the English were coming. And meanwhile, he picks me up and he says to me in Russian, which I understood. He said, before you die, take a look. I do have pictures from the English soldiers that took it, and I don't have it here. Anyway, it cannot be shown everything.
Yes.
It didn't, really, the movie was not meant to show my whole life because it takes, you know, 2-3 days to tell you. But anyway, and he says to me, before you die, look at here, the liberation. So I still managed to see all the SS men and the women standing there. I have a picture, standing up. And then he put me out, you know, this was, you know, April 15, it was cold. And when the doctor, the English doctor, gave me the first aid.
And then you were... So, Sonia, you and I have another connection.
Okay.
You see, when you felt those earth shaking, when you imagined that perhaps you were going to be freed, when you saw those British tanks arriving, I want to show you a photograph of my father. You see, my father was...
The liberator?
He was in one of those tanks.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. My liberator, see?
And my father was in the first British tanks to arrive at Bergen-Belsen.
Really?
Yeah. He was...
Is he still alive?
No, Dad died a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
But he was one of those who arrived to your rescue in
That's
April
right.
15.
Correct.
My dad was one of your liberators.
So I couldn't even see, you know, enjoy the liberation in the day, you know, you can imagine,
So there's Fred.
Yeah.
Who didn't talk much about the war, but he told me that he was one of those first...
First ones, yeah.
Who'd have thought, there Sonia, that here we are, all these years later, that, you know, I wish my dad had known.
Yes.
That you... You were.
He probably would remember because
that you were alive, and that here you are, and all this life that you've lived.
Yes.
It would have made his life so much more meaningful, knowing that he helped liberate you and your friends.
Oh, listen, they were wonderful to us. But it was such a disarray, they didn't know what to do because the typhus was all over. Because after then they had to burn, they moved us up, you know, where the SS used to live in the barracks there. And this was, you know, of course I had to be, the one was turned to be a hospital and they took care of us in it. But I also want to mention, I don't know if your father ever told you, the English, you know, the army, where they were liberators, they were begging the people, our boys and girls, not to eat more what they're getting. Because when you, from starvation, your stomach shrinks like a baby stomach. And you have to eat very gradually, very little. Luckily, I was in the hospital. I had to only eat what I was, you know, received. And some of our, it's really very hard for me to talk about it. They died because they ate more than they supposed to.
They died because they ate too much of the food.
Yes.
Sonia, we need to move through displaced persons camp. Then you found yourself moving to the United States.
Yes.
And in this photograph, who do we have here?
This is Regina, then myself, and then her sister Debbie is there, and my son Maury.
So your two daughters and your son.
Correct.
And you in the middle.
Yes, I'm very proud of them. But I want to mention about my husband, Jan.
Yes.
He was liberated also in Bergen-Belsen.
Yes.
But if the English would have come 2 weeks later, he wouldn't have made it. He was on last strings of typhus. And mention about typhus, I want to tell you, it's very important. I had typhus when I was in the ghetto. And the Germans were very scared about it. So if any family had somebody who had typhus,
yes.
They were telling, you have to report. If not, they would come and kill the entire family. So me and my brother wind up just an abandoned, it was not a hospital, just an abandoned house. No medication, nothing, and I made it and he made it. But all of those years, when people are dying of this horrible typhus, I never understood that I didn't get any typhus.
Yes.
Then later on, after the liberation, when I asking this question, once if you have it and you make it, you get immune, and that helped me in a big way that I didn't have typhus.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, Bergen-Belsen, as you should probably also know, mention about what is her name from Holland, what she died.
Yes,
there.
Anne Frank. Anne Frank died 2 weeks before the liberation.
Exactly. Also,
so
2 weeks.
Anne Frank was in Bergen-Belsen also with Sonia.
Correct.
And died 2 weeks before the liberation.
Exactly.
At the beginning of April.
So she must have been also in the death march.
Yes.
With me too.
Yes.
Yeah.
So then moved to the United States, wonderful family. Sonia has been in business with John for many, many years, and more recently relocated the Taylor shop.
And then he passed away, it was 27 years.
27 years, and then kept John's Taylor shop open for many years.
And as you know, 36 years we were in Metcalf South.
Yes.
And then in the movie, it's interesting for history for the Metcalf South.
Yes.
You see it the way, you know.
That's right, at the mall in Metcalf
South. Exactly, yes,
South.
Yes.
And then most recently, your granddaughter has helped to tell your story.
Correct.
Big Sonia Survivor, Grandma and Diva. It's now on DVD, as you heard. And it's also not only on the Big Sonia website, but on Amazon. And November, you can make your pre-orders now, and they'll send it to you on November the 6th when it's released on Amazon. So a really wonderful DVD, a wonderful story to be told. Sonia, one of the things that I gain from hearing you tell the story is the power of storytelling. For you, I can only imagine to some degree, the healing that comes from telling the story because you are carrying the torch of those who cannot.
That's right.
And also for those who hear that story, the impact that it has had on their lives. We see that in the DVD, we hear it in the voices told.
Yes.
Of people whose own lives are transformed no matter what the conditions are that they're facing. Because of
putting love in their heart,
hearing the story of love, which is yours. I'm moved to have met you. It's a special honor for me to interview you.
Oh, it's an honor to me too, to meet you.
And
too.
My father, who died in 2014 at age 89, would have been honored to know you.
Yeah.
And I'm so pleased that today we've had this opportunity. Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you,
please join me in thanking Sonia Warshawski.
Thank you for having me. Thank you. Thank you. And let us spread love and kindness. And please, whenever there is hate, please take out any hate. Because when you start hating, you destroy yourself.
Yes.
And you become a hater.
Love conquers fear.
So that's the reason
fear.
I say in schools, don't follow the crowd. Educate yourself and then decide what is right and wrong.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.